we're so blessed to have great musicians with great attitudes that love the Lord, and they're always willing to help. Thank you guys for your service. And I'm going to ask you now to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 17. We're going to start a new chapter today, John chapter 17. We'll begin reading together in verse 1. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Beginning in verse 1, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you sent. I have glorified you on earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you, Lord, that we have the privilege of studying it. Lord, we're free in this great country, Lord, to be able to study your word and to be able to worship our Lord Jesus Christ without fear of persecution. We thank you, Lord, that we get to be taught from your heart today. And we pray, Lord, that we'll open our hearts and we'll be ready, that we will listen to you with a willing heart. And Father, forgive us where we've sinned against you, we pray. And Lord, bless this message and do your will in our hearts, we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So in the last few chapters of the Gospel of John, last few weeks, we've been looking at this section where Jesus has been talking with his disciples as they were walking along that path that led them towards the Garden of Gethsemane. They left that room where they were eating the Last Supper, and they got up and they started walking, and they're heading towards the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus knew that he would be arrested in that garden and taken to the cross to be crucified, to put on trial and then to be crucified. And all the way along, as they walked this path, Jesus was talking with his disciples, and he was teaching them everything that he could possibly teach them in the precious little time that he has left. He was using this very little precious time he had left to prepare these men to go out and preach his message after he's gone, in a world that's very wicked, a world that's going to hate them, a world that's going to persecute them. And so they need him to impart to them everything that he can possibly impart to them. They're going to need it all. But as we come to the beginning of John 17 this morning, we see a very big change in the action of what's going on. We see a transition, because here Jesus is transitioning from this time of teaching his disciples to a time where he is praying. This prayer that Jesus prays in John 17 is going to take us all the way through this chapter. From beginning to the end of this chapter is a prayer of Jesus. And in the first 5 verses of this chapter, Jesus is praying for the Father to be glorified. In the verses 6 through 19, the next section, Jesus is going to be praying for his disciples, which we're going to be looking at that over the next couple of weeks. And then astoundingly, beginning in verse 20, Jesus is going to be praying for you and me. I don't know if every one of you know that, but the night that Jesus went to the cross, Jesus prayed for you and me. Every person who's going to believe through the word that his disciples preached. And that is us. And when we get to that part of this prayer in a few weeks, that is something that you should definitely not want to miss, because that's going to be a huge blessing. It's amazing. But this morning, we're only going to look at the first 5 verses. And so if you were going to skip a morning, it should have been this morning. But I've got you here, so I'm going to go ahead and preach to you. You heard about the preacher that went out to an old country church, and when he got there, there was only one farmer that showed up for church. And as he got ready to begin his sermon, he said, "Well, should I just preach, you know, or not? You know, there's only you here and me." And the farmer said, "Well, preacher," he said, if I went to feed my cows and only one showed up, I guess I'd feed him." And the preacher, very encouraged by that, he said, "Okay." So he got his Bible out and he started preaching. Preached for an hour and 45 minutes. And then he got done, and the old farmer said to him, "Preacher, when I said I'd feed one cow if he showed up, I didn't mean I'd feed him the whole bale." I'll try not to keep you too long this morning, but what we have here is amazing. And before we start getting into it, I want you to understand something, that the further we get here, the holier the ground upon which we're walking. As your pastor, I don't always expect you as church members to be serious about everything. I love to laugh and have fun. We were laughing this morning because the other day I was out at a restaurant, saw Rebecca and Aaron there. We were at Rose's last Sunday afternoon with the young people. I saw Aaron and Rebecca. I leaned in to give Miss Rebecca a hug, and there was a baby in a high chair, and I poured hot sauce all over this baby. I was like so worried it was going to be in the baby's eyes and the baby's mouth, you know. And I was cleaning the baby. I was apologizing to the parents. They're like, "It's okay, it's okay." And last night I got a picture of some spilled hot sauce from Brother Ron Conway. Wanted to know if we were going to have any baby baptisms today. I didn't get it whenever I saw it. And then I remembered, oh, yeah. I'm the guy that poured the hot sauce on the baby. Didn't mean to. We love to have fun, don't we? We don't mind cutting up. And I would love it, though, if every time we open up the Word of God, that everybody sat up and took it seriously. If every time we open up the Word of God, that people understood with all their hearts that God is about to speak. Not that I need to be respected when I speak, but God's Word needs to be respected when it's going forth. And I know people get distracted sometimes, and I've learned to be patient with that. But guys, if there's ever a time when you need to really get serious and really tune in, this is it. This is Jesus praying and pouring his heart out to God the Father during the last night, just a few hours before he went to the cross and died for our sins. We're moving right into the main event here, the central focal point of everything that the Bible talks about, the most important event that ever took place in the history of the world, when Jesus went to the cross and died for you and me. As we near that place, we're going to get an insight into what was going on in the heart of our Lord Jesus as he was getting ready for the cross to happen. And guys, if that doesn't make you feel the need to get serious and listen and really pay attention, then I think you really need to stop and think about what's really going on in your heart, because something's not right if we can't take these things seriously. As we go through this passage, I see four things here that Jesus was concerned about in his heart. Four things Jesus just prays to the Father about. He's asking his Father that these things can be accomplished through his death on the cross. And as we go down through this, I want you to notice how totally selfless Jesus is. We so often pray for things for ourselves, and that's okay. But in everything Jesus did, he was always thinking either, and everything we see in this prayer, he's always thinking either of his Father or for us, but never about himself. And so let's look at this together. If you're following along on your outline, the first point is that Jesus is praying that what might be accomplished through the cross, the first thing he's asking is for his Father's fame in the world. He wants his Father to be glorified. And he says in verse 1, he said, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. When Jesus is talking about his hour that has come, he's talking about the time when he'll finally go to the cross and die. And as you make your way through the Gospel of John, we've come all the way through it to this point. You'll notice the subject of his hour coming up again and again. And the last couple of Sundays while we were studying back in chapter 16, we read verse 21 where Jesus talked about a woman when she's in labor. One of our ladies, her hour came this week when she was in labor. And Jesus used that same term. He said when a woman is in labor, she has sorrow because her hour has come. She knows it's going to be tough. But as soon as her labor is ended, she forgets about all her pain and she rejoices because she's brought a baby into the world. And that's a joyful thing. And what Jesus was explaining to his disciples was that he's about to go to the cross and suffer through some terrible things for us. But when all the suffering's over, then there's going to be rejoicing because of the great things that have been accomplished for us through the cross. And when we read through the Gospel of John, there are seven different times where we read about Jesus speaking about his hour coming. And most of the time, it is something like Jesus says that his hour had not yet come. But here in John 17 in verse 1, this is the seventh time that his hour is mentioned. And this time, the Bible says Jesus lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. It's finally here. In other words, he knows it's finally time for him to go to the cross and die for the sins of the world. He knows it's finally time for him to go to the cross and experience all that suffering. And by going through all that suffering, he's going to accomplish all those good things for us that are going to bring us joy. Okay? But notice what Jesus prays as he goes to face that suffering. Verse 1, Jesus said, Father, the hour has come. And here's what he asks. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. Now, I want you to think about the fact that there's nothing selfish that Jesus is asking for here. And there are two great reasons why we can understand that. I want to share them with you. First of all, Jesus is not asking to be glorified just so that people in the world will think that he's great. Jesus is asking, and we do think he's great, and that's great. But Jesus is not asking for that purpose. Jesus is asking to be glorified so that he can show the world how great his Father is. Not just saying glorify your Son, he's saying glorify your Son so that your Son may also glorify you. And it's not so much that he's trying to get attention for himself, but rather that he wants to demonstrate to all the world how great his Father is. Now, secondly, we need to understand that there's nothing at all selfish about this when you simply consider the way that Jesus is about to be glorified. He's not receiving an award here. He's going to the cross to go through the worst kind of shame and humiliation that man can unleash upon him. They're going to mock him. They're going to spit in his face. They're going to beat his back bloody with a whip. They're going to strip his clothes off of him and nail him to a cross naked and let him die there. Not for anything he's done. He died there like that, humiliated like that, because he was bearing the shame of our sins, my sin. He got there what I deserve. And that doesn't seem very much like the attention, the kind of attention or glory anybody would ever want or ask to have at all. You might ask, how could he talk about the cross like that? How could he say that he was going to the cross to be glorified? And how is something like that going to bring glory to the Father? That question will bring us to our second point in our study this morning. He's praying that his father's family might be with him. Verse number 2, Jesus said, "As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him." That is how Jesus gets glorified through the cross. Because when it's finished, when all the suffering is done, when all the shame is accomplished, when everything about the cross is finally accomplished, then the debt of sin is paid. All my sin, all your sin. And Jesus is able to give eternal life to anyone who will trust in him. So even though everything he went through looked like shame, when it's all done, he gets glorified because he's giving forgiveness of sin and eternal life in heaven to all who believe. And not only that, but his Father gets glorified because the Father loved us enough to send the Son into the world and do this great thing for us. Jesus said, "It's the Father who's given all these to me that I'm going to give life to." They're doing this together. And so the Son gets glorified. And as the Son is glorified, the Father is glorified too. Also, don't miss this. You don't want to miss this, because Jesus here gives us a very important definition of what eternal life is. Not only that, he tells us, not only is he going to tell us what eternal life is, but he's going to go on and tell us again, as he's done several times lately, he's going to tell us again how we receive it. So verse 3, Jesus says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you." Who? Who's he praying to? The Father. "This is eternal life, that they may know you." How can you know God the Father? Through Jesus. That's the only way. "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." And remember, the gospel story is that God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to save sinners by dying on a cross. And that's the truth that we need to trust in. Back in John 16, 27, Jesus told the disciples, "The Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from God." That was God's plan. That was the Father's plan to save us by sending his Son into the world to do this for us. And when you put your trust in Jesus, you put your trust in the work that Jesus did on the cross of Calvary, you are saved. And God gives you the gift of eternal life. That's how you receive eternal life, by trusting in him. But now listen to how Jesus defines eternal life for us. Jesus told us here in verse 3, "This is eternal life, to know the only true God and Jesus Christ, who he sent." I know the idea of eternal life makes us think about living on for millions and millions of years of eternity. And that's true, and that's pretty cool. But that's not the best thing about eternal life. The best thing about eternal life is that we're going to get to know and be friends with and live in a love relationship with God the Father and his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so really, it's good that we get to live forever and ever. But the real emphasis that Jesus is talking about here is not just the quantity of time, millions and millions of years, but the quality of eternal life that we're going to have there, because we get to be there with the Father and with Jesus, and we're going to know them on a personal level. And I can't really think of a better verse of Scripture to describe it than that great promise of Revelation 21 in verse number 3, where it says, "He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no sorrow, no crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Can I get an amen in the house of God today? Now, you want to glorify God and praise him for what he's doing for us. We're going to get to live with him in eternity, and all our tears are going to be wiped away. All our pain is going to be gone, and we're going to be able to praise him forever because of that. And it's all because of the cross, all through Calvary. And that's one of the ways Jesus is glorified. And that's how, when he's glorified, his Father is glorified through the cross, because through the cross he can give us that kind of eternal life that he's talking about. But there's another way that Jesus is glorified through the cross. And that brings us to our third point this morning. The third thing that Jesus was praying for is his Father's finished work. Jesus is praying for his Father's finished work. In verse 4, Jesus says, "I have glorified you on the earth." Jesus says to his Father, "I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do." Jesus, just a few hours from his death, and he can look up to heaven and he can pray to the Father with a confidence in his heart, knowing that he's been totally obedient to everything his Father sent him here to do. It's kind of like that statement that Paul made over in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 6, where he said, "I'm ready to be offered. I'm ready to go on to heaven, face the Lord, because I have finished my course. I've run the race. I've kept the faith. I know the Lord is going to reward me and give me a crown." It's kind of like that. And you know, Paul's statement had to be just a little bit different because from the one the Lord Jesus made, because I know that Paul regretted the fact that he had hated Christ and he had persecuted Christians earlier in his life. I know that he had some regrets in his heart from his past, but even so, by the grace of God, that was all forgiven. And ever since Paul came to know Jesus Christ, he had followed him and obeyed him, and he looked forward to standing before God knowing that he had been forgiven, and that ever since he'd been forgiven, he had been faithful. He could stand before God knowing that. But here's Jesus, and it's even and better in the final hours of his life, with death just a few hours away, and it's a big deal to him that he has perfectly lived an obedient life before the Father, never sinned, never disobeyed. He has perfectly lived an obedient life before the Father. He is happy that he can go into the presence of his Father, knowing that he's done everything he could do to live his life to glorify the Father. And he's going to do this last thing now. He's going to the cross to absolutely finish everything. A good son glorifies his Father. I know I've shared this story before, but years ago, back when Ashley and Brett, my two oldest, were just little kids, we would go out to eat at a restaurant. Strangers, we didn't even know, would walk up to us and give us compliments on how well behaved our kids acted. All the time it would happen. And you know, that made us feel so good as parents. That made us proud as parents, proud of our kids' behavior as parents, because that used to happen to us all the time. But I promise you, it never happened a single time since Daniel was born. Never happened again. I'm serious. But you know, that's the kind of thing. When I'm out at the store and I see some six-year-old kid and he's pulling his little brother's hair and he's knocking stuff off the counter and he's kicking and screaming and throwing a fit in the floor because his mom won't buy him a pack of cigarettes, you know, and he's just mad. And I don't really get mad at the kid, but I get really frustrated with the parents. And sometimes I just want to go over to help those parents and say, you know, and say, "Sir, ma'am, I believe your child has maybe a chemical imbalance. But all the right chemicals are located right here on the backside of the body. And if you'll just whip that backside hard enough, you'll send them the right chemicals right up to the brain. If you will just, seriously, if you will just do what the Bible says with your child, love that child, but spank that child like the Bible says. It's what the Bible says. You're going to do that child a world of good. A world of good." I did that with all four of my kids, and it worked out great with all 3 of them except for Daniel. But still working out great for Daniel. He's a great kid. I got a compliment the other day on the phone. A couple of compliments about him. But don't tell him. I don't want him to know that. But we know that to be true, don't we? That a little brat who won't behave speaks bad things about some bad parents. But a well-mannered child who behaves and does what he's supposed to do is a compliment to both his parents that they are good parents. And when Jesus was getting ready to die, to go be with his Father, it was important for him, and he was happy about the fact that he had lived his life obediently. He had lived his life in such a way that he was giving his Father glory by the obedient life he lived. And guys, don't try to avoid this thought, because one day you and I are going to stand face to face with God. We're going to be facing the end of our lives too, just like Jesus did. And the question is, are you going to be able to go be with your Father having the same confidence and joy that you lived your life obedient to give glory to God? Or are you going to have regrets because you insulted God with all the things you didn't do right and all the things you did do wrong? Is your life going to give God glory because you're selfless and obedient child of His? Or is your life going to give Him no glory because you're disobedient, a brat who lives only for yourself? Because it's one way or the other. Glorify your Heavenly Father with the life that He's given you to live, please. It's what Jesus did, and it was so important for Him. He says, I've glorified you, and now I'm going to finish this last thing, Father. I want to do this for you. Fourthly, and finally, this morning, Jesus was praying to His Father about His Father's fellowship. He wanted that fellowship back that He had with Him. And then He says that in verse 5. He says, now, O Father, I'm going to finish this. He says, now, O Father, glorify Me together with Yourself with the glory which I had with You before the world was. Jesus is telling us there was something very special when I was in the throne room with My Father. A very special unity, and we were both glorified together. But out of love for sinners in the world, I stepped out of that and I left that behind. I want you to know Jesus stepped down so far when He left the glory of the throne room of heaven and came down to this earth in a body of flesh. He left behind that perfect fellowship that He shared with His Father and came down here where people wouldn't understand Him, where people would not appreciate Him, and some of them would hate Him, betray Him, murder Him. He left behind the royal heavenly robe for the purple robe of Calvary that they put on Him to mock Him. He left behind the kingly heavenly crown for that crown of thorns that they platted on His head that pierced His brow and the blood came running down His face for you and me. He left behind the throne of heaven where He was exalted to the cross of Calvary where He was humiliated and crucified. But He did it all willingly out of love for you and me. And I think of all the things He left behind, I think probably the one He missed more than anything else is that perfect fellowship that He had with His Father. Remember when He talked about returning to heaven, He always was saying, I want to go be with My Father. I'm going to be with My Father. And now He's facing the cross of Calvary. He says, Father, glorify Me together with Yourself. Can't wait to get back and be with You. Glorify Me together with Yourself for the glory which I had with You before the world was. He's ready to finish this job and then get back there with His Father where He deserves to be and be glorified with His Father like He deserves to be. Can we stand?